Hi, my name is Max Feinstein and I'm an anesthesia resident at the Mount Sinai Hospital in New York City. In this video, I'm going to be explaining the difference between spinals, epidurals, and combined spinal epidurals, and also what this guy is doing back here. If you find this video interesting or helpful, I'd really appreciate it if you liked it and subscribed to the channel. I'd also recommend that if you don't like looking at videos or images of needles, you check out a different video of mine. This probably wouldn't be the one for you. The word epidural actually just refers to a space between two layers of tissue in the back, namely the ligamentum flavum and the dura. And the epidural space contains a number of different things, including lymphatics, some blood vessels, and nerve roots that travel through. When doctors refer to placing epidurals, what we're really referring to is placing a piece of plastic tubing inside of that space so that we can deliver medication through the tubing. I'm sure what immediately caught your eye as you started watching this video is the fact that this half mannequin is in a really weird hunched over position. And the reason for that is that positioning is an enormous part of a successful epidural placement. If you take a look at this model of a spine right here, where these are the spinous processes, which is what you would feel on somebody's back, you can see how when the model is up straight like this, there's really no way to pass anything in between the spinous processes. But if you have a patient who is hunched over like this, you can see how the space really opens up in a way that would allow you to pass, in this case, a needle in between the spinous processes. Before I show you the relatively large 17 gauge TUI needle that we use to place the epidural catheter, let me first show you the small 27 gauge needle that we use to inject local anesthetic so that patients don't feel the TUI needle going in. This is that small 27 gauge needle we use to inject local anesthetic. After having placed hundreds of epidurals, I can tell you that what's generally the most painful part is just the bit of stinging that occurs for about 10 seconds or so from the local anesthetic. Once the local anesthetic's in place, then we go ahead and start inserting the 17 gauge TUI needle, which looks like this. You can appreciate how the TUI needle has markings every centimeter so that we can keep a very close eye on how deep this needle has gone. One of the really important features of this needle is the special tip that it has, which is designed to allow the passage of a plastic catheter that will go up into the epidural space and not continue forward. A common way to identify the correct anatomical location for placing either a spinal or an epidural is to start by palpating the patient's iliac crests.
The iliac crests are at approximately the level of the L3 to L4 interspace, which is a common place to insert a spinal or an epidural.
And so once I've identified that interspace, I put a finger on either side. Here I've got my local anesthetic, which I'll start by injecting superficially to make sure that the patient doesn't feel the TUI needle going in. Some people also like to use this needle as a quote-unquote finder needle to make sure that you don't run into any type of bone as you inject deeper. It's worth pointing out that the epidural space is typically at least 5 centimeters deep from the skin, or possibly more depending on the patient's BMI. And a needle like this is only about 4 centimeters long, so it's generally not going to be deep enough to even get to the epidural space. Now that I've identified where I'd like to place my TUI needle and I've anesthetized that area, I'll go ahead and very carefully insert the TUI needle, and I can feel as I'm going past each one of the ligaments. And what I'm feeling for is the ligamentum flavum, which has a very distinct hard stop. But you have to be extremely careful when doing this to not advance past the ligamentum flavum, which can lead to an inadvertent dural puncture and result in a complication called a post-dural puncture headache. If you watch closely, you can see that my needle meets some resistance right here, which corresponds with the ligamentum flavum.
At this point, I'll very carefully remove the stylet from the TUI needle.
Now I can attach a syringe that's filled with either air or saline, and in this case I'll use air, so that I can very slowly transverse the ligamentum flavum. And once I've gotten just to the other side of the ligamentum flavum, this air-filled syringe will collapse and allow me to know that I'm in the epidural space. So I advance, tap, advance, tap, advance, tap, advance, tap. And you can see how the air very easily goes in now, allowing me to be quite confident that I have reached the epidural space. At this point, I detach my syringe. And now I'll take my epidural catheter and thread it through the TUI needle. The epidural catheter comes with depth markings on it, so I can know exactly how far I have to advance it. Now that I've advanced my epidural catheter, I can very carefully remove the TUI needle while simultaneously making sure that the epidural catheter stays exactly where I placed it. At this point, the TUI needle itself is out and the epidural catheter remains in place. Now I'll apply sterile adhesive dressing over the epidural catheter so it doesn't move, and then I can continue to infuse medication that goes through this catheter into the epidural space. There are a number of different medications we can administer through the epidural catheter. Very commonly, we'll give a combination of a local anesthetic called bupivacaine, as well as an opioid called fentanyl, both of these in extremely low doses. Combining medications like this allows us to deliver a smaller dose of each one of them because they work synergistically to provide anesthesia. I should point out that when we do include opioids in our epidurals, it's typically in such low doses that it doesn't cause any amount of euphoria or any kind of feeling that would evoke addictive behavior. Typically, the amount of time it takes for the medication going through an epidural to relieve pain is about 20 minutes, give or take. And that can really last for as long as we need it to, as long as we continuously infuse the medication through the epidural catheter into the epidural space. That's also why epidurals can be really excellent choices for pain control after major abdominal or thoracic surgery, where we can continue delivering medication through the epidural for as long as the patient is in the hospital and needs pain relief. The term spinal refers to an injection of medication that goes in the subarachnoid space, which is located deeper than the epidural space. The subarachnoid space contains cerebrospinal fluid, nerve roots, and blood vessels that go to those nerve roots. It's extremely important to point out that the spinal cord ends at approximately vertebral level L1 or L2 in most people. And so when we're placing spinals, we are doing that below the level of the spinal cord so that we don't cause any damage to it. Again, start by numbing the area with a small 27 gauge needle and a bit of local anesthetic. And then through the anesthetized area, we insert a special short needle called an introducer. And an introducer allows a longer, more flexible needle to pass through and eventually reach the subarachnoid space. The spinal needle easily passes through the introducer, and once we think that we've reached the subarachnoid space,
we remove the orange-tipped stylet that's inside the spinal needle.
This allows cerebrospinal fluid to drip back and let us know that we're in the right location. And at that point, we go ahead and connect a syringe to the spinal needle and inject our medication into the subarachnoid space. For placing a spinal, I'll again start by identifying the iliac crest.
Palpate the L3, L4 spinous processes and identify the interspace.
Use a local anesthetic to anesthetize the skin. Take my introducer needle and bevel up. I will insert the needle into the target area. This needle should advance all the way, and then into the introducer, I'll take the spinal needle. And here I'm again feeling for ligamentum flavum, which I just felt myself go through.
And so I'll go ahead and remove the stylet.
And if this were a person, this is where I would expect to see cerebrospinal fluid floating back at me, at which point I could take the medication that I intend to inject into the subarachnoid space, connect to the spinal needle, draw back slightly to make sure that it draws back easily and that I get more cerebrospinal fluid, and then go ahead and inject the medication which goes into the subarachnoid space. I'm going to go ahead and remove all of these apparati together. Just like with epidurals, the medication that we choose to deliver through a spinal can vary depending on what exactly the surgical and patient's needs are. Namely, where exactly does the patient need to be anesthetized and for how long? For example, in C-sections, it's very common to use a combination of the local anesthetic bupivacaine, also mixed in with dextrose, and also mixed in with an opioid, for example, fentanyl. Spinals can last up to several hours, more or less, depending on exactly what the formulation of medication was that was delivered into the subarachnoid space. While spinals are very commonly used for C-sections, they're also very commonly used to provide pain relief for hip surgery or knee surgery so that we can allow a patient to not feel anything below the level of, say, their belly button for a several hour period, and then once the surgery is done, they'll start to regain sensation and then we can provide pain control as needed. Also, just as a side note, when people refer to a spinal tap, they're referring to accessing the same subarachnoid space with a needle, but instead of delivering medication into it, the tap refers to draining some cerebrospinal fluid from it for analysis in a laboratory. Now that you know what an epidural is, and you know what a spinal is, then you can guess that a combined spinal epidural is both of them combined. And it's actually really cool to take a look at the needle that allows us to do both a spinal and an epidural at effectively the same time. Recall that when we're placing an epidural, we use this TUI needle to thread the epidural catheter in place. Well, when we want to do a combined spinal epidural, then once we've got the TUI needle in place, we can inject medication into the subarachnoid space that is, recall, deeper than the epidural space by inserting this Gerty Marks needle or something similar through the TUI needle. So we take our TUI needle, which has gotten into the epidural space, and we can insert a Gerty Marks spinal needle that goes through that and will penetrate even deeper and get into the subarachnoid space. Once we've accessed the subarachnoid space using this 26 gauge Gerty Marks needle,
we can take out the stylet,
which leaves a hollow needle in place. At this point, if we were doing this on a patient, you would be able to appreciate cerebrospinal fluid dripping back from the Gerty Marks needle. And then we can connect a syringe of whatever we're using for our spinal and inject it directly into the subarachnoid space. Once we've completed that injection, we keep our TUI needle exactly in place and remove the Gerty Marks needle that was going to the subarachnoid space. And now we still just have our TUI needle, which is in the epidural space. We can start inserting this flexible plastic epidural catheter, which goes directly through the needle, like this, and you'll be able to see how, instead of going straight forward out the tip of the needle, it comes out at an angle, and when it's in the epidural space, it will actually just point straight up. We typically advance the epidural catheter approximately 5 centimeters into the epidural space, and you can imagine it would be pointing up just like this. At the other end of this plastic tubing is an injection port that allows us to connect to any medication that we'd like to continuously deliver through the epidural. Just like for both the epidural and the spinal, I'll start by identifying my landmark, the iliac crest, going over to approximately the L4 to L5 interspace, using my local anesthetic to anesthetize the area where I'm going to do the combined spinal epidural. Perhaps I'll use it as a finder needle as well. Now that the area is anesthetized, I again take the TUI needle . I am now feeling for the ligamentum flavum. That will be met with a change of resistance and oftentimes a bit of a click that's either felt and or heard. Once I've gotten to the ligamentum flavum,
I remove the stylet from the TUI needle.
Again, I will take either a saline or an air-filled syringe, connect and very gently push through the ligamentum flavum, and I'm feeling for a loss of resistance, which you can appreciate right here. I will now disconnect my syringe, take my Gerty Marks spinal needle, advance it through the TUI, and I'm feeling again for a loss of resistance.
Once I've lost resistance, I can go ahead and remove the stylet from the Gerty Marks needle.
And this is where, if I were doing this on a person, I would see cerebral spinal fluid floating back at me, at which point I could take the medication that I'm using for a spinal, connect to the Gerty Marks needle, gently draw back to make sure that it easily takes back some CSF, and then very gently inject the spinal, and then I'll take out the Gerty Marks needle while leaving the TUI in place, which then allows me to take my epidural catheter and thread it into the TUI needle, just as I did before, as part of a regular epidural. You might see this in cases where a patient is having their third or fourth C-section, and we anticipate that there's going to be quite a bit of scar tissue that was created by prior C-sections. So the C-section itself is going to take a longer period of time. So we'll need the immediate effect of the spinal and then continue to provide pain relief with the epidural, hence combined spinal epidural. If you found this interesting and would like to see videos about different types of procedures, why don't you check out this video that I made about inserting a very large IV called a rapid infusion catheter. Thanks very much for watching, and a big thank you to the Mount Sinai Department of Anesthesiology for letting me use the equipment and space to make this video. See you next time.